Thank you. Who gives this woman to be married to this man?
On behalf of our parents, we do.
Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth. Except the Lord build the house, they labor in vain that build it. Dearly beloved, we are assembled in the presence of God to unite this man and this woman in holy matrimony, instituted of God, regulated by his commandment, blessed of our Lord Jesus Christ, and to be held in honor among all men. This sacred relation is to be entered into soberly, advisedly, discreetly, reverently, and in the fear of God. Into this beautiful and holy relationship, these two persons desire now to enter. They desire to take each the other as husband and wife for prosperity or adversity, sickness or health, poverty or riches, and to perform all the duties belonging to such a relationship to the end of life. To some of these duties, as laid down in the Holy Scriptures, I now call your attention. God said, "It is not good that man should be alone. I will make and help meet for him." Our Lord declared, "For this cause shall a man leave his father and mother and cleave to his wife, and they twain shall be one flesh." The Apostle Paul, speaking by the Holy Spirit, said, "Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it." May the spirit of Ruth, the ancestress of our Lord, accompany this couple as they journey through life together. Entreat me not to leave thee or to return from following after thee. For whither thou goest, I will go, and where thou lodgest, I will lodge. Thy people shall be my people, and thy God, my God. Amen. You're now invited to join in the singing of number 468, Praise to the Lord, the Almighty.
Thank you.
I assume you're ready, Logan?
Yes.
Okay. He's ready. And I can see you're ready, Christina. Before we begin the ceremony, that which you are waiting for, and that which we came to witness, I would turn to the scripture as recorded in Paul's letter to the Colossians, chapter 3, reading from verse 12 through 21, reading in Jesus' name. Put on, therefore, as the elect of God, holy and beloved, tender mercies, kindness, humbleness of mind, meekness, long-suffering, forbearing one another, and forgiving one another. If any man have a quarrel against any, even as Christ forgave you, so also do ye. And above all these things put on charity, which is the bond of perfectness. And let the peace of God rule in your hearts, to the which also ye are called in one body, and be ye thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. And whatsoever ye do, in word or deed, do all in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, giving thanks to God and the Father by him. Wives, submit yourselves unto your own husbands as it is fit in the Lord. Husbands, love your wives, and be not bitter against them. Children, obey your parents in all things, for this is well-pleasing unto the Lord. And fathers, provoke not your children to anger, lest they be discouraged. Amen. The apostle is writing in a general sense to all Christians, the beginning of our text. Our text begins with a phrase that he uses repeatedly, even in this portion of scripture that we read and a few verses prior. And that phrase is put on. What does it mean to put on? Put on, therefore. So we have to look back a little bit what he's speaking about or writing about. And in verse 10, just a few verses prior, have put on the new man, which is renewed in knowledge after the image of him that created him. Verse 9, before that, as we back up, says put off the old man in his deeds. So Paul is reminding them, instructing them, that they have put on the new man. To put on is to assume something. It is something concerning our standing in God, in Christ Jesus. The Bible tells us in the book of Galatians that all of you who have been baptized into Christ have put on Christ. Paul also writes unto us in the Roman epistle that as we have been buried with Christ into baptism, likewise we have been risen up into eternal life, and therefore we should walk in the newness of life. I really butchered those two verses, but I think you're probably familiar with them. Maybe I should have written those down rather than rely on memory, but it's the same thought here of putting something on. For an example, Christina, when you went wedding dress shopping, I could just assume, and I've never been wedding dress shopping, and I never will be. It's not my part. It's not our part. Logan, I assume you weren't there either. Right, right. But I would also assume that you didn't go alone, and you're struggling into these dresses one after the other, but you probably had a whole entourage. Your mom, your sisters, and sisters-in-law, friends, cousins, and depending on where you were shopping, probably one or two attendants, right? And they're trying these dresses on you, putting these dresses on you. And I think that's a beautiful picture. I'm sure even before the wedding ceremony, you had attendants helping you out. You were putting that on. And in that putting on of this wedding dress, which is very beautiful, by the way, you assume the position or the status of a bride, right? You put that on. Everybody recognizes Christina as the bride. Even if they maybe don't know you, they would recognize you as the bride. This is what it means to have put on Christ. As he has robed us, operation of God, even as we read, through the glories and the wonders of baptism as he gives unto us the newness of life wherein we walk. It is a work of God that he has called you both into this wonderful and marvelous relationship with the Father through the merits of Jesus Christ. And he robes us, doesn't he, with a perfect, wonderful robe of righteousness, a robe that is beyond any whiteness that we could ever imagine here on earth. That is where you stand now as his preciously purchased children, elect according to the foreknowledge of God. The Bible tells us, as far as this election, you are a chosen generation. You are chosen from the beginning of time, before time. You have been elected in Christ Jesus to be his children. And I might expand this a little bit more, even that you have been chosen for each other. God has done this. It is also an operation of God, as he has brought you two, children of God, together in this, what we call, holy matrimony. Chosen generation, a royal priesthood and holy nation, a peculiar people, a called out people, that you should show forth the praises of him who hath called you out of darkness and into his marvelous light. And as you put on your wedding dress, put on your suit, you put on, having put on this robe of righteousness, you leave the old man behind. Logan and Christina, I would say probably a year or so ago, before you met, you were doing your own thing, right? And you were probably in that, sort of selfish. And I'm not saying that in a negative way. You're doing what is right that you think, you know, for yourself and so on and so forth. And now, being you have put on a new cloth, you will do something for the other. You're not serving yourself anymore. You're not single anymore and serving yourself, but you will serve the other. And in that also is a picture of God robing us with his righteousness, as our works are not selfish anymore, but our works are for the benefit of our brother. We go on, as we have put on or assumed these virtues, these Christian virtues, attributes of God, which have been put on by our faith in Jesus Christ, by his grace. Tender mercies, kindness, humbleness of mind, meekness, long-suffering, forbearing, bearing with each other, that's what that means. Bearing with each other and forgiving one another. Oh, if we could, all of us who are gathered here today, whether whatever our station is in life, and especially for those of us who are married, if we could forbear or bear with each other and hold each other in forgiveness. If any man have a quarrel against any, even as Christ forgave you, so also do ye. How do you forgive each other? Through Jesus Christ. I can do all things through Christ which strengtheneth me. And without him, we can do nothing. So the forgiveness and the forbearance that you have one for another comes from that, flows from that robe that has been placed upon you. That robe of righteousness which is Christ Jesus himself. Forgiveness. Even as Christ has forgave you, so also do ye. And above all these things, put on, there's that term again, put on charity, which is the bond of perfectness. What a wonderful thing here, this charity, which is love in action, that is evidenced in a godly couple as you serve one another. Faith, hope, and charity, as Paul writes in the 13th chapter of Corinthians, abideth faith, hope, and love, or charity, but the greatest of these is love. Faith and hope lead one to knowledge. They produce something, but love produces more love. Are we on? Okay. Well, the beauty of modern electronics, that can all be just taken out of your videographer's video ink. Okay? Where were we? Love. Love. And love produces. Love produces more love. And I believe that is such a beautiful picture there when Paul speaks of that now abideth faith, hope, and love, all wonderful attributes which are given to us. But the greatest of these is love. As you have would fulfill and you are perfected in your faith and your hope, when it becomes sight, but love continues. And in your marriage together, as individuals and collectively, you will, by the love of God, produce good and wonderful works. By God's love, which is shed abroad in your hearts. Above all these things, put on charity, which is the bond of perfectness, and let the peace of God, Jesus, who is our peace, rule in your hearts, to the which also you are called in one body, and be ye thankful. As I said earlier, this is written for the congregation as a whole, but I believe we are speaking to Logan and Christina this afternoon, and maybe we could concentrate a little bit on them even, okay? Let the peace of God rule in your hearts, to the which also ye are called in one body, and be ye thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you. This has the same connotation as put on. That is not something that you're doing, as you didn't struggle to get into this dress by yourself. It's put on. Also, would you then let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. Can you picture your family, your home? What will your home be like? Will it sound like this? I trust that it will. That it will be filled with praising God, music that is glorifying God and strengthening you in your walk as you continue as His children. Whatsoever ye do in word and deed, do all things, secular things, spiritual things, all things. You don't walk two walks of life. Your walk is single, isn't it, as a child of God. Do all in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, giving thanks to Him and or to God and the Father by Him. This is really maybe an explanation or a picture of the good life. What is the good life? That you would have new cars every year, a new house every 10 years, and so on and so forth. Well, yes, those are blessings of God, and we wouldn't say that those are in and of themselves bad things, but the good life is to walk as a child of God. Walk daily, ever looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of your faith. And now, here's where I will speak to you, Christina. Wives, or wife, maybe I should say Christina, submit yourselves unto your own husband, unto Logan, as he will then, or he will now, assume the responsibility for you. We talked a little bit about this, didn't we? Submission, authority, and all those scary big words. But really what it boils down to is he has the responsibility for you. And do you love her? Yes. Do you cherish her? Yes, you do. And you'll take care of her then because of that. Because the love and the charity that you have in your heart towards her, love in action, will make it easy. No problem for you to submit yourself unto Logan. Husbands, love your wives. Quite often, maybe in this day and age, we think that it's such a heavy thing for a woman to do is to submit herself unto her husband. But I look at this, maybe because I'm a husband, I think I have the difficult job. Love my wife. Not that my wife is unlovable. Boy, that's scary territory here. But, you know, to continue to love her in spite of anything else, in spite of any difficulties that you might have, the day at work and you come home and things just haven't gone quite right, but above all that, you would love your wives. As we read earlier, even as Christ loved the church and gave himself for it. That's the love that would be evidenced in your life. Be not bitter against them. Do not be indifferent or callous toward your wife, but practice charity. Looking forward, if God so grants, children, obey your parents in all things, for this is well-pleasing unto the Lord. Fathers, provoke not your children to anger, lest they be discouraged. That God would bless you. If he sees fit, that you would bring children into the world, that you would be able to raise them in the nurture and the admonition of the Lord, which is indeed your prayer. May God richly bless you as you now enter into life together, having put on Christ. And in so doing, you can walk in newness of life. In Jesus' name, amen. Now join in the singing of number 488, God Leads Us Along. charge you both, as you stand in the presence of God, to remember that love, loyalty, and faith in the Lord Jesus Christ will avail as the foundation of a happy home. If the solemn vows you are about to make be kept faithfully, and if steadfastly you endeavor to do the will of your Heavenly Father, your life will be joyful, and the home you are establishing will abide in peace. I entreat you both to seek the help of God in this sacred moment and to look to Him steadfastly for His love and grace, which will make your marriage rich in comfort and fruitful in service. Logan, will you take Christina to be your wedded wife, to cherish her and live with her according to God's holy ordinance? Will you pledge your loyalty to her and promise to love, honor, comfort, and keep her in health and in sickness, in prosperity and adversity, and keep yourself unto her only so long as you both shall live? If so, answer, I will.
I will.
Christina, will you take Logan to be your wedded husband, to cherish him and live with him according to God's holy ordinance? Will you pledge your loyalty to him and promise to love, honor, comfort, and keep him in health and in sickness, in prosperity and adversity, and keep yourself unto him only so long as you both shall live? If so, answer, I will. God of all grace and goodness, thou hast heard the declaration of these thy servants. May it please thee to bless them, as they are now about to be joined together in holy matrimony. Guide them and sanctify them by thy Spirit, and fill them with a profound sense of the holy obligations of the vows they are about to make. Help them to look to thee for thine assistance, and to enter into these sacred obligations in humble dependence upon thine enabling grace. Grant all of us these mercies, O Father, we ask, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. In token of your readiness to assume these obligations, you may now join your right hands while I propose to you the marriage covenant. Rings, please. Logan, take the ring and repeat after me. I, Logan James Lampinen, take thee, Christina Louise Matson.
I, Logan James Lampinen, take thee, Christina Louise Matson.
To be my wedded wife.
To be my wedded wife.
To have and to hold from this time forth.
To have and to hold from this time forth.
For better, for worse.
For better, for worse.
For richer, for poorer.
For richer, for poorer.
In health and in sickness.
In health and in sickness.
To love and to cherish till death us do part. According to God's holy ordinance and as a token thereof.
According to
God's holy ordinance.
According to God's holy ordinance.
And as a token thereof. I give thee this ring.
I give thee this ring.
And to this I do pledge thee my faith.
And to this I do pledge thee my faith.
Repeat after me. I, Christina Louise Matson, take thee, Logan James Lampinen.
I, Christina Louise Matson, take thee, Logan James Lampinen.
To be my wedded husband.
Be my wedded husband.
To have and to hold from this time forth.
To have and to hold from this time forth.
For better, for worse.
For better, for worse.
For richer, for poorer.
For richer, for poorer.
In health and in sickness.
In health and in sickness.
To love and to cherish till death us do part. According to God's holy ordinance,
according to God's holy ordinance,
and as a token thereof, I give thee this ring, and to this I do pledge thee my faith. Now I ask to join in the singing of number 302, The Love of God. By the authority committed unto me as a minister of the gospel, I declare that Logan and Christina are now husband and wife, according to the ordinance of God and the law of the state, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. What therefore God hath joined together, let not man put asunder. You may kneel. Let us pray. Most merciful and gracious God, of whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named, bestow upon these thy servants the seal of thine approval and thy fatherly benediction, granting them grace to fulfill with pure and steadfast affection the covenant and vows made between them. Guide them together, we beseech thee, in the way of righteousness and peace, that loving and serving thee with one heart and mind all the days of their life, they may be abundantly enriched with the tokens of thine everlasting favor, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Now hear us, dear Father, as we unite our hearts and voices in that prayer which Jesus taught, saying, Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, bless, preserve, and keep you. The Lord mercifully look upon you with his favor, and fill you with all spiritual blessing, so that your sojourning here will glorify God and be to your mutual benefit. Amen. God bless you, Christina. All the days of your lives. God bless you, Logan. Beautiful couple. You may now stand. Logan, you may kiss your bride. Gives me great pleasure to introduce to you Mr. and Mrs. Logan Lampinen. Invited to join in the singing of two songs, Number 371, Great is Thy Faithfulness, and number 558, Blessed Be the Tie. After which time, we will join Logan and Christina and their families in the church dining area for the reception. Please remain seated until the ushers, Aaron and Evan, excuse you from your seats and exit the sanctuary through the doorway to my right. Before we sing, I would ask for a blessing on the meal which has been prepared. Dear good and gracious God, as you have fed us in the past with all the natural blessings of this life, as well as spiritual blessings, we ask that you would now bless this food which has been prepared for us. Bless the hands that have prepared it for us, and may it strengthen our bodies in service one to another. Bless the time of fellowship that we have, one with another, as truly our fellowship is with thee, with thy Son, Jesus Christ, where the blood of Jesus cleanses us from all unrighteousness. This we ask and we pray in Jesus' blessed and holy name. Amen.